Hey everyone, thank y'all for being here. I really appreciate it. This is our third event with Radom Capital. This is one of my favorite developers in Houston, and actually kind of all the US to be honest. I'd like to start off by thanking our sponsors, Able Design Group, Blue Kite Building Group, Lazor Group, and Sandlot Engineering. I'm also happy to announce that Able Design Group will be our title sponsor for 2023. They're in the audience, so thank you all very much for that. We appreciate it. Love it, love it. With that, I'm incredibly excited to be back with Radom Capital. This group continues to impress with some of the most innovative, creative retail and office spaces to come to our city. They are the team behind some of Houston's most significant projects, including Heights Mercantile, MKT Heights, 3201 Allen Parkway, Montrose Collective, and many more, to be honest. While we love having them focused on Houston, they're doing great things, not only continuing in Houston, but they're also doing some great projects in San Antonio now and beyond, which is really exciting. We're incredibly lucky to have Evan Peterson here, principal, and Stuart Walker, development manager with Radom Capital on our panel. To chat about the Heights Clock Tower, which is to our right, and their new office space, which is to our left, just behind the clock tower. With that, we'll go ahead and get started with some introductions. So, Evan, good to see you.
Good to see you too, Randy.
Thank you, thank you. Can you tell us a little bit about your background and how you came to work with the Radom Capital team?
Yeah, no, so my background, by training, I'm a landscape architect. So growing up, I was always interested in architecture and design, so I've always had a passion for creativity. And I think kind of from transferring the field from kind of design into development, especially when I first started working with Steve, when it was really kind of, there's really just three of us in the office, more or less, you know. I remember the first time I met Steve, and I kind of showed him more or less my portfolio, my interest, and him and I instantly connected in our kind of vision and design and really the importance and the value that it brings. And I think that's a reoccurring theme you can see with our project. And also too, I think as a landscape architect too, my background, we like to think of green space not as something ancillary in our projects, but really as an anchor and something that brings all of our projects value. So, you know, we really just, I was originally a landscape architect. I met Steve through some mutual friends, and he actually owned and worked in the building that I worked in, and then that's how we met and connected. And then ever since then, we've been off the races doing some great projects, and you know, I think we've been able to do some really great things in the city of Houston over the past 6 years, so it's exciting to be here.
Excellent, excellent. Stuart, how about you? What's a little bit about your background and how did you come to work with Radom?
So, in college, actually, my background, I studied wildlife management. So, nothing really to do with construction or development. But came back to Houston, didn't know what I was going to do. Ended up working for a property management company in their construction department. Worked my way through there and then made a move over to Harvey Builders. Worked there for a few years, building medical projects in the Med Center and nonprofits throughout Houston. And then actually, Evan and I started talking during COVID, right before COVID, about me coming over to the Radom team. And COVID happened and kind of put the brakes on that, and everyone kind of stayed still. And then we started talking again, I guess, 2 years later, a year and a half later, and really got to know the team and the projects, and kind of in my mind thought it dovetailed great into my wildlife, me personally, in my mind. My wildlife management background and conservation and stuff like that with these old historic buildings and
definitely
and how they work. And after years of seeing Houston just kind of cleaning slates and building tall towers,
tear down, build new,
exactly, it kind of dovetailed into my interest and seeing really cool projects instead of just cookie cutter stuff that we all see around town. So they're definitely special projects, and that's what I wanted to get into.
Great, great. No, I think it's a perfect match. So here we are in yet another creative retail and office space from Radom. You guys really are doing fantastic at that. We're here at the Heights Clock Tower. But it's more than creative retail and office space. It's also adaptive reuse project and the historic landmark. So Evan, how does Radom Capital continue to hit on these kind of complicated adaptive reuse projects that I think a lot of developers just shy away from, as we were talking earlier, you know, kind of tear down and build new? I think it's got to take a lot of vision, a lot of commitment to work with the city, understanding of the various programs out there to assist with these kind of adaptive reuse projects. Please let us know.
You know, I think our success is as much a reflection of our passion as it is the consumers, to be totally honest with you. I think people these days more and more want differentiated things in differentiated spaces. You know, it's something that kind of ends up making your project successful. You know, there's no denying that kind of an adaptive reuse project, something with history, especially in a city like Houston that candidly is so young, where if you really look at our city, it's really only about a little over maybe 100 plus years old if you really consider our true time period. So it's I think it's something like this where these buildings bring more value in such a new place in comparison to Chicago or like in New York. And then, you know, once again, people's just desire for something in the world where you have so much sensory experience, both through Instagram or online or anything, but just to come to somewhere that's just so differentiated and different. And then also too, I think there's just, like I said earlier, it's just something special and unique about historical properties and adaptive reuse that that people just enjoy, you know, and it's differentiated once again.
I mean, everything's, you know, online these days. You know, you still have to put a shopping center in, put the clothes in there, people are gonna come, but that's not what it takes these days.
Well, if you look at it and people can work from home these days, you know,
you
really have to make them have a desire to want to come to their office space.
Absolutely.
You have to make them want a reason to come to work and want to kind of be a part of this environment. And like with this landscape, with this awesome cafe next door, you know, you want to give people an exciting reason to come into the office and to collaborate with their peers.
Absolutely. Now, I remember reading a lot about what the pandemic could do to retail and office, and it's just raising the bar, right?
It's true.
To get people to come out.
So. The days of the million square foot boxes are kind of, they're slowing. They're not coming to an end, but it's just, you know, people really want something differentiated in terms of their experience.
Absolutely. Absolutely. All right, so can you share some history about the Heights Clock Tower, kind of dating back to the 1800s?
Yeah.
And then also some of the different renovations that have taken place over the time. And then when you're kind of done with that, I'm also extremely interested about the outdoor spaces, which are just extremely unique.
Thank you. Thank you for that. No, I think, so this building is on, it's in the National Register of Historic Places. What we call the Heights Clock Tower. It was rebranded recently with the prior owners. It's actually the Oriental Textile Mill building. And there's actually buildings that were built from about, I want to say, the late 1800s to about the early 1920s. And as we walk you through the buildings, we kind of show you like some of the old walls that existed. And you can kind of start to see where the original buildings were, where they kind of added on. And it was originally a mattress making building.
Interesting.
And this is actually a kind of a crazy fact, but they used to actually import hair from India and make mattresses with the hair. It's like that was kind of what they did here. What you see here, this is the old boiler room.
I would not have guessed that.
Yeah, I know. That's a little wild. But you can see the old boiler room here, the smokestack, kind of this is where the coal was. Our office was the old bunkhouse where the people used to live.
Oh, wow.
And so like you can go through, you'll see some of the fire doors too and all these kind of historical elements that were preserved throughout the property. So and after that, there are various businesses that kind of took this place here. Another kind of weird, eerie fact is the Heights Candyman, the serial killer, used to work here back in the day, apparently.
Wow.
I heard that the other day.
Wow.
I promise it's not haunted. I haven't heard anything, at least.
It's not.
But
interesting.
But yeah, no, and then the wonderful family, the Grenaders, actually came here prior to us. We purchased it from the Grenaders, and they did a phenomenal job of kind of renovating the interiors. Nonia Grenader, Jonathan Grenader's wife, was a Rice professor, wonderful teacher. She was the main architect here as well. They did made some really great strides in renovating this building, and so we kind of came here, acquired, really kind of took the exterior spaces and also kind of took the interior spaces to really that next level.
Excellent. So with the exterior spaces, I mean, where's the detention? Did y'all have to do underground detention here?
Yeah, we did.
So there's actually, if you look at like our new park area over there, we did the most hardscape work. We have a large detention vault that really makes up for the majority of the property. So
okay.
That's where the majority of our detention is, and it's kind of slim chamber system. But then besides awesome. That, we're really just really working with landscape and permeable surfaces. So luckily that was kind of how we really wanted to approach it, you know.
Excellent, excellent. No, I love it. It's a beautiful building, so congrats on that. So can you tell us a little bit about the different tenants here? I mean, I think we all know Crafts and Baking and have probably had some drinks and pastries over there, which we love.
Yeah.
But I think there's some design studios, some real estate brokerages. Who else is in this space here?
So yeah, we have, I think buildings like this always lend themselves to creatives, obviously. You know, we've got quite a few architecture firms that were here before we even leased here, like Reg and Andre. And then when we took over the building, you've got Ben Johnson Design kind of moved in, took this main boiler space right here to our left.
Awesome.
We've got some marketing firms. We actually have we've got a trading firm that manages the Omani Southern Wealth Fund.
Okay.
And so we really have a diversity of tenants here, and that's what we strive for.
Yeah.
So, you know, I think, but definitely there's a lot of design and more creative firms here, but I think everyone at this point really just wants creative space. And that's really, I think traditionally you would have thought this building is really more architects and like designers and engineers, but you know, we're really starting to see more diversity in the tenancy because everyone just kind of wants these cool differentiated spaces.
You gotta get people to come in the office, you know, it's gotta be something different.
Exactly.
No, I've always been impressed with the type of tenants y'all bring. I mean, I think a lot of first-time Houston retailers have come to MKT Heights, have come to Montrose Collective, including La La Land, Kind Cafe, and a whole slew of other retailers. So, I mean, it's just creating that elevated project that gets people over the hump to come over. So that's great. So thank you for the comments on the history and on the project. I'd like to turn my attention over to the new office headquarters. Stuart, can you tell us a little bit about what your team is currently, or where your team is currently officing out of, and how you guys came to choose this new space for your development?
Yeah, so we're currently at 714 Yale Heights Mercantile. Originally, that space is probably designed for about 4 or 5 people, and I think we're, 14 now? So
it's fantastic.
Grew out of it, and just need more space. The original plan was to be in Montrose Collective. This plan was before I joined
Which
the team.
Which is where Marmo is, and
correct,
La La Land Kind of Cafe.
And to be in that area, and or in that building, and we just needed more space. So
we also had a tenant that came through and said they wanted the space, so you kind of... Well, you gotta support your capital partners.
And you're
too.
In the business of leasing space,
exactly.
So that makes sense.
Yeah.
Okay.
So yeah, then this space, a tenant had to move and or was moving out. So I think we saw an opportunity to have a really cool, unique office and awesome. Not just a brand new space, have something with more character, and we chose this place.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it's in line with y'all's brand, so it makes sense. I think we talked about a lot of the big projects you guys have done, but I think you guys have been very active in the Heights and really all over. You know, what does it mean for you guys to be in the Heights? And when I think of some of your other projects, I think about 375 West 19th Street, which is where Jenny's Ice Cream is located. You know, I'm not sure a lot of people know that you guys have done multiple projects throughout the Heights. So what does the Heights mean to you guys? You know, why was it a good fit for you guys?
So me personally, I'm kind of from the neighborhood on the other side of the tracks, I guess south side of the Heights, but it's kind of home to me. I know that's kind of a cliche, but I mean, I remember visiting friends' houses over here and kind of running around in the Heights once you get your driver's license and stuff like that. So to see the change and have it become a more up and coming, or dare I say, not diverse, but it's not homes anymore. You can have an office here, which is super cool.
Yeah.
And you can walk next door and
see the change and be a part of the change and stay with
the change. I think Stuart brought up a great point with change, where it's like, I think Houston itself is a city that's very open to change. and I think it's a new city every 5 years, honestly.
Yeah, it really
is. So it really is, and to kind of, really, we actually, with kind of some other projects on White Oak, on 20th Street, and then eventually kind of Heights Mercantile, which is our first flagship project, we've been a part of that change, integral to it. So like Stuart said, the Heights is home to us.
Yeah. The Heights Mercantile project, I mean, I think that was one of the first projects where you took like a bike path and you integrated it into the development and brought the public in, and now you got these open air markets constantly.
Yeah.
It's fantastic.
That's great.
Okay, so a little bit more, could you tell us a little bit more about the specific office building? I think we touched on it briefly, but what was the history of it? You know, what was its previous life? And then how are these renovations going to meet the demand of Radom as you guys grow?
Yeah, so as Evan mentioned, that's kind of where the bunkhouse used to be. But more recent history, the art guys.
It was an art studio prior to that.
It was an art studio, and then a few tenants,
office
in the space. And it was kind of bare. It was more of just open space. But even when we started demoing out, I mean, there was still a shower in there. From when the art guys, I guess, lived back there.
Yeah, they lived there.
It was like
the
studio.
The art guys, I think there was a building off I-45 where they actually were going to, it's where that cross used to be.
Okay.
You're coming on I-40, the Pierce Elevated.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
And they were actually going to put some walking arms on that building, and they were going to move.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah,
yeah. They had a potential.
That was actually Stuart's old employer, by the way.
Yep, we owned the building, and that was their proposed deal.
What happened to the arms?
Well, it's kind of hard to put giant arms on a building.
It was cool, though.
It would have been quite a challenge.
Yeah, absolutely.
But yeah, so they lived there, and you know, I'm sure it went through a couple tenants' hands. But it's like, to meet our demand, I mean, you know, 12 people in a smaller office, I mean, this is going to be way more space.
Yeah.
And as Evan was mentioning earlier, I mean, you got to get people to come to work and stay at work.
Absolutely.
And this is just, for me, it's just a better fit.
And the Heights Clock Tower is your footstep.
Heights Clock Tower, windows.
Yeah.
Big, large windows, a lot of light. I mean, it doesn't feel like a cold office.
A private patio and a private courtyard.
Private patio, private
Very
courtyard.
Cool. All right. Well, thank you to our panel. We really appreciate
it. Thank you for coming. We appreciate it.
All right. Let's go ahead and get started with the tour then.